even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Your period love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near. And I will feel no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I? On a glorious light beyond all compare, and there will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, we'll live to know you here on the earth, and I will feel no evil, for my God is
Jesus, there is no one. Thank you.
breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only.
Tonight, our scripture reading is from Matthew chapter 14. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, Jesus went up the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone, but by this time, the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, he came walking toward them on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It's a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." So Jesus said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became frightened, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." Here ends our reading. Let us pray. God of the wind and the sea, you invite us to be brave, but we are more familiar with fear. You invite us to trust you, but we'd rather trust wind and gravity. You invite us to believe in ourselves, but we often don't think we're good at it. You invite us to move, to change, and to take risk, but we stay planted where we are, afraid of the ways growth might hurt. Forgive us for our self-doubt and fear. We believe despite our unbelief. Amen. Unraveled, seeking God when our plans fall apart. Honestly, having your plans fall apart isn't a matter of if it's going to happen, but when. Sometimes it can happen in small ways, simple things where you've decided you have your day planned out, you're very happy that everything's scheduled and it's good to go, and then the day starts. And it starts with just a little bit of unraveling, and soon you get to the end of the day and you realize nothing that you put on your calendar actually got done. Anybody have a day like that? Hopefully not today, but maybe so. Other times, plans can unravel in pretty big ways. Things that we don't plan on and we don't want to have happen, and yet they unravel. So I've been praying for my friend Kim. We've been friends since confirmation. And her son was in a car accident a couple days ago, and things really unraveled for them. Her son is a young adult. He races cars on a track for fun. And yet this was a simple day. He was just getting in his car and it happened to be foggy out. And the car went off the road. Thankfully, he's okay. But after surgery, he's okay. But for them, it was an event that unraveled everything. And Kim has been saying how she's seen these bright lights, these bright spots, and all this time, that being thankful for the medical staff that helped them, being thankful for friends who brought meals to them so they didn't have to worry, because life had unraveled for them in a big way. When things unravel for us, we realize that we're not in control. And that can often be a scary thing, to realize we're not in control. And yet it also can be a time that we can be set free. It doesn't have to be a negative thing to not be in control. And oftentimes when things unravel, it's when God shows up in our life. Because often God takes all those unraveled bits and pieces and weaves them together, turns something that is broken into something beautiful again. And when things unravel, that's the time that we don't mind taking a risk that might lead to something good, because the plans have not worked anyway. So why not try something else? Just like Peter, when he was in the boat, he didn't plan at the beginning of the day to say, "Well, by the next morning, I'm going to walk on water towards Jesus." All these things were happening, and suddenly, Peter had a new opportunity in his life. Now, tonight, we're looking at when we're unraveled by uncertainty. And I don't know if I've met a lot of people that like to be in that place of uncertainty. It's a little easier to be pretty certain about what's going to happen. But sometimes there are good things that can happen in the midst of uncertainty. But being unraveled by uncertainty can feel a bit jarring. Again, it can happen in small ways. Like Friday night, harvest moon, a beautiful night. I was invited out. I see Lori's in the back. Lori was trying to get a group together to go hike Black Elk Peak in the full moon. And all these people had plans, some wonderful things going on. So it was Lori, it was myself, and it was my son Corbin, who was very excited. He'd never done a night hike. But when the sun went down and it was beautiful and then it got dark, my son was like, I don't know about this. It's really dark. The trail is kind of different. He had a little bit of uncertainty in him as we went along on that hike. But it was a beautiful night to get to the top of Black Elk Peak and nobody else is there. And you get to experience the moon and the stars. And then you go back down the trail and suddenly things again looked a little different. And you don't trust yourself and suddenly you think, wait, did we take the wrong trail? Okay, we passed the big rock. No, we're on the right path. We'd let that uncertainty creep in, and so we weren't trusting ourselves, and as you can tell, we're here, so we made it off the trail that night. But sometimes you're unraveled by uncertainty in big ways as well, right? Maybe you've jumped into a new job, and the interview was great, and then suddenly you're into month two, and uncertainty creeps in, because you're like, was this a good idea? My boss seems a little bit different now than on the interview. Did I make a big life change for the right reason? Have you ever been there in a big change in your life and suddenly that uncertainty starts creeping in and you wonder if what you've done is what you should have done? Because when we get to that story of the boat and Peter and the disciples and the storm, and maybe you wonder, why did Jesus go off by himself? What was he doing going up to the mountain and praying and chilling out while the disciples were in the boat? Just before our story, Jesus fed a whole crowd of people. You know that story about feeding 5,000 people? Woo! Maybe Jesus is an introvert, and it's time for him to get away and get recharged and be ready for the next part of what he's called to be. For whatever reason, he's on the mountainside, there in the boat, and the storm hits, and the waves begin. Could you imagine the uncertainty that's in that boat and in those disciples in that moment? They're thinking, are we gonna make it? Are we gonna have water in the boat and we're gonna be scooping out water? And then when they see a figure walking on the water, of course they're uncertain and thinking, who is that on the water? That wasn't how they planned their day. Their whole world is suddenly filled with uncertainty. And I think about that moment and each of those disciples and what they're doing. And maybe you find yourself in there as well. Maybe you're the disciple in the boat who's like, I'm scared. I don't know what's happening, so I'm not going to do anything. My doing something is going to be by doing nothing. Because I know oftentimes when we get filled with uncertainty, it's hard to do anything. And then there's Peter who's like, woo, yeah, I'm out of the boat. I'm going to step out and I'm going to go towards Jesus. Whoops, wait, what am I doing? Have you ever been there? You're all excited. You jump out into things and then you think, wait, maybe I shouldn't have done that. And then Peter finds himself sinking down into the water. And oftentimes, many of us have found ourselves sinking into uncertainty. Sinking into all those negative emotions, sinking into debt, maybe sinking into one bad decision after the other, sinking, until reaching out and saying, somebody pull me out. Somebody get me out of these waves of uncertainty in my life. I'm not sure what I'm doing. All of those moments of uncertainty were happening for them, for the disciples, for Peter in that boat as well. Now, oftentimes, you may have heard the story, and people say, well, the moral of the story is just keep your eyes on Jesus, and if you just have enough faith, it'll all be okay. You know, that sounds good, but then that's putting it all on your shoulders. If you just have enough faith, if you just believe enough, if you just watch Jesus all the time, you'll be fine. But we know it's not always the case, right? It's not always that easy. But in that story with Peter walking on water, what often gets forgotten is that who was already walking on the water? Who was already out there going towards them to reach out to them? Jesus was already there. He was already going towards them. And when Peter falters and falls down and is afraid, it's Jesus who's reaching out to him as well and saying, I'm here. I am here. It's not about what Peter does, but it's what Jesus is doing and already has done for each one of those disciples, including Peter. So I think about our own lives and the uncertainty that we may find ourselves in. And it's a reminder that something has already been done for us, and it's been done through these waters. Have you ever been up at this place, at this font? Have you ever seen a baptism when we say baptized in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit? These are the waters that reach out to us. These are the waters that pull us up. These are the waters that offer love and forgiveness. You don't have to be good enough or make sure you have more faith or do more things. It doesn't matter where you're at. If you're filled with uncertainty or filled with wonder and delight every day of your life, these waters are here to tell you that God will walk towards you and reach for you today, tomorrow, and every day of your life. Because these waters aren't unraveled by uncertainty, but they unravel uncertainty and give you the promise of God forever. Amen.
Set your rule and reign in all. If we can invite any ninth grade youth out there and your parents to come on up here. There we go. I will just keep backing up. All right. Any more? All right. Tonight is their ninth grade milestone. It's going back to school, but going to high school, starting new. And I'm starting to think about what does it mean to start high school? You get to try all sorts of new things. New classes, new programs. You even get to meet a whole group of new friends. And new possibilities of friends. This is the beginning of an exciting time. Now, I know that there's a bunch of us as adults that go, I would never go back to high school. And I see some nodding of heads. But if we were, what would we do differently? We would all probably try something new. Something that we would have liked to have tried, but what happened? We let fear take over. Right? We started to be afraid. There's these voices in our heads that say, oh, I can't do it. Oh, that might be uncomfortable. What if somebody looks at me weird? And so we don't always make the correct decisions. So as you go through your year, I want you to think about having faith. Faith that God has created you to be the amazing people that you are. This entire church has watched you for the last quite a few years. I know I've been here 5 years and I've watched each of you for 5 years, and some of you even longer. And God has created you to be amazing youth and young adults. And you're capable of amazing things, so I want you to have faith in yourself and then also faith in God, that God wouldn't put you in some really bad place. And then after all, you're standing behind, there's people standing behind you that I want you to have faith in also, that are here for you to support you and care for you. And you're surrounded by a whole great cloud of witness that will also be here for you. Kelly found these online. These are pop sockets, and they're supposed to go on your cell phones. And I know you guys never use your cell phones, but when you do use your cell phones, they say faith over fear. To have faith about you, the God that created you, and the family that supports you every day. And the church that knows the great things you're capable of. Let us pray for each of them. Pray with me. Dear God. Oh, come on. Dear God. Thank you for all these ninth graders. They truly are amazing. We pray that they know that they are amazing. And that you support them every day. Amen. Now, kids, I want you to turn to your parents. And parents, I want you to make the sign of the cross on their forehead. And just say, you are amazing. You're created to do great things. God loves you, and so do I. Youth, your turn. Make the sign of the cross on everybody's heads that's around you. And say, thank you for supporting me. Thank you for being there for me. I have faith in you.
I have faith in myself, and I have faith in God. I love you, and thank you. Give them a round of applause. All right, they're already heading out. Thank you. Let us pray. Gracious and ever-living God, we thank you for being in our life, for reminding us that we are supposed to get out of our boats, out of our comfort zones, that you know that you're there to support us. Lord, quiet the storms of fear in our life. And help us to be your people each day. Lord, we pray for those that are hurting in mind, body, and spirit, those whose health isn't what it'd like it to be, those who are wondering when the better day is coming. Guide us this day and each day, and help us to know all your good gifts. Lord, we pray this in your name. Amen. On the night he was betrayed, our Lord took bread, broke it, and gave thanks and gave it to all to eat, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new cup, my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." For as all of you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, we proclaim the Lord's presence here and now and for us. Now let us pray the words our Savior continues to teach us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. This is the Lord's table. All are welcome. Come eat. This meal is for you. Just a little guidance for tonight. For those of you who are new here, how we do communion, we do it in tinction, which is a fancy way of saying we take the wafer and we dip it. And then we take that. For those of you up in the balcony, you will come down on that side and go back up those stairs. I'll meet you all in the back, and then the rest of you will come forward in this way and head back that way. So it's pretty informal. Come and follow the ushers a little bit.
That the highest king would welcome me. I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Ooh, the sun sets free. Oh, it's free. Father. place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. We welcome and inspire all with grace, courage, and love. Have a great night.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I'll worship your holy name.
The sun.
sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I'll worship your holy name. Worship your holy name.